what she was saying. So anyway, so respect to that joke, I think in the Hokie Nation, we can claim Dr. Donita Brady as our own. Okay, she went to school in Radford. So if Radfordians, you want to claim her, she's also ours. So I'm really pleased to have her here. This is the second interaction we've had this year. At the first interaction, she just blew me away. She was one of the speakers at our Mid-Atlantic ISD symposium, a new group we put together. And she didn't just blow me away. Her science told me that other people liked it. She had just published a paper in Nature. I tracked her down. I said, what else is going on? She said, I just received the KA award. I said, we need to bring you to Tech so you can talk to our students. And of course, that's, you know, that's what she has done. And she surprised me. She said, oh, I went to school in Radford. You know, and I we always deemed Limer. So forever, we will not deem Limer again in our that's discussions. Right. Limer, you have a top bid in your discussions. So another thing that I found out about her, which is also near and dear to my heart, besides the science, is that she was a scholarship actor. That's a really fun thing to know, that you were humble and you did summer internships. You didn't just get, you know, a scholarship to school, but you did all these great things as an undergraduate, and then you went up to UNC to do your PhD because you did your summer internship there. And then after that, you all this great stuff you've done and with respect to prophecy telling and the effect of population has on tumor genesis. I think it's a great work. I think just that one paper in Nature makes you as ours. So please join me in welcoming our own Dr. Donita Brady.
So thank you, Ed, for the kind introduction. It's been great to interact with a lot of the IMSD and PEP team here at Virginia Tech, and it's great to be back in the New River Valley. So today I'm going to tell you about some of my most recent work on the interplay between copper acquisition and the MAP kinase signaling cascade that we're trying to use at Duke University for a new therapy in BRAF-driven cancer. And so, since my research training started, I've been interested in the lines of cellular communication that are often deregulated during the process of tumorigenesis. And these often drive many of the biological capabilities that are acquired by tumor cell lines. And here I've depicted one of the hallmarks of cancer, which is sustained proliferative signaling. And I've illustrated that here through this signaling cascade from A to D. And this unchecked regulation of these pathways is one of the hallmarks of cancer. But also, and that leads to regulation of cell cycle regression, cell survival, and gene expression. Well, what's also important is that you've lost the brakes in cancer cells. So the pathways that normally inactivate these kinase signaling networks are often lost. And these are these hallmarks of cancer that I've been interested in since my research started. Our lab studies the family of RAS small GTPases. They function as molecular switches, switching between GTP-bound on states and GTP-bound off states. And the GTP-bound conformation, this causes intramolecular changes of the proteins, causing engagement of downstream signaling factors that then turn on signal transduction to regulate many processes. And I've shown three of these major pathways that RAS talks to here. But as many of you may know, RAS is commonly mutated in cancer, so a third of human cancers will harbor mutations in these RAS small GTPases that lock them into their constitutively active states. And when in these constitutively active states, they chronically signal through these pathways. The first a pathway illustrated here is the PF3 kinase, lipid kinases that activate AKT. The RAF serine threonine kinases that stimulate the canonical MAP kinase pathway. And the RAL GEFs that exchange on the RAL GTPases, GEP for GTP, activating these small proteins, small G proteins. But today I'm going to tell you about my work that mainly focuses on the regulation of this pathway and a novel signaling paradigm that links copper to this pathway. So in trying to uncover in vivo functions of small GTPases, many people have gone to model organisms to do this. And so as illustrated here, in 2005, Caldwell et al. Used the prothoracic gland of Drosophila. This is the key organ that regulates fly body size. And they expressed the oncogenic version of RAS in the prothoracic gland. And as you can see here, in comparison to wild type expressing flies, the flies that express oncogenic RAS are much smaller. This is really interesting to them. And they also found that expression of BRAF or RAF could also cause a small fly phenotype. So suggesting that the MAP kinase pathway depicted here is important for this phenotype. This is really was really intriguing to our colleagues in the pharmacology and cancer biology department at Duke University who are looking at copper biology. And in order to look at copper biology in model organisms, they decided to use this same exact model system. And they plugged in their favorite high-affinity copper transporter, CTR1. CTR1 forms a trimer at the cell surface, and is the major way in which copper gets into microbes and mammalian cell systems. Once inside the cell, copper is delivered to many redox-active enzymes, like superoxide dismutase, which is going to reduce hydrogen peroxide, or the electron transport chain in the mitochondria. What's interesting is that they found that knockdown of the high affinity copper transporter CCR1A in the prothoracic gland led to this large fly phenotype in comparison to the scramble control. And so this is analogous to dominant negative RAS expression. So an inactive version of RAS when you express the prothoracic gland leads to a similar phenotype to the loss of CTR1. So suggesting that there's a genetic interaction between copper transport and RAS signaling in this phenotype that's regulated by growth. So we next wanted to test this potential interaction between these two pathways. And in order to do this, we use the Drosophila I, which is a system that is exquisitely sensitive to MAP kinase pathway activation. So as shown here, expression of oncogenic RAS in the Drosophila I leads to this rough I phenotype, and this is due to the fusing of omatidia. We use the same system to try to understand what happens if you get rid of copper import. So we simultaneously expressed CTR1, RNAi, and the Drosophila I, and found a complete diminution of this phenotype in the absence of the copper transporter. So this was validation that there is a genetic link between RAS signaling and copper transport. But how could this be happening? And is this conserved from Drosophila to mammalian cell systems? So in order to try to investigate the RAS signaling that could be happening, we went to a genetically defined cell system. So here we're using CTR1 wild type and CTR1 null mass. And we're stimulating them with a receptor tyrosine kinase ligand, FGF. And you see after 5 to 10 minutes of stimulation with FGF, you get strong induction of the MAP kinase pathway, as read out by phosphorylation of ERK1-2, the downstream target of this pathway. However, in the absence of CTR1, you see a reduction in the activation of the MAP kinase pathway. This was interesting to us because we went on to look at activation of the entire pathway in the absence of copper. And in the interest of time, I'll summarize that data. We found that in the absence of CTR1, that RAS activity was normal, that RAF phosphorylation was normal, and that MEK1-2 phosphorylation was normal, suggesting that the difference in these CTR1 null cells was between MEC being able to phosphorylate its downstream target, ERK. And that led us to test whether or not these kinases that are critically important for cell cycle regulation could be copper binding kinases themselves. In order to do this, we expressed MEC1 and MEC2 in E. coli and purified the recombinant protein, and then tested whether or not it could bind to a copper charged resin or a free resin. In this biochemical assay, we find that both human MEC1 and MEC2 are capable of binding to this copper charged resin. So this is a nice way of showing that these kinases can bind copper, but we needed more quantitative measures to be able to test this binding. And in order to do this, we went on to a biochemical assay in which we're measuring the affinity of copper 2 for MEC1. We're using the spectral chromophore part here that has a spectral reading at 500 nanometers for binding to copper. And so that's shown here at the top. With very little MEC, you see this intense signal at 500 nanometers. As we titrate in more recombinant MEC1 protein, we see a reduction in the copper PAR signal, suggesting that the copper is now being loaded onto the MEC. We were able to get an affinity based on this assay, and we found that it was 10 to the minus 18, so this is very tight binding of MEC to copper. And to further explore this, we wanted to find out whether or not copper had an effect on the actual kinase activity of these proteins. In order to do this, we did a series of in vitro kinase assays where we took recombinant MEC1 and incubated it with a kinase dead version of its substrate, ERK2. As expected, if you incubate either MEC1 or MEC2 with kinase dead ERK2, you get activation of the kinase as read out by phosphorylation of ERK2. However, if we add copper sulfate to these reactions, we get an increase in the phosphorylation of the downstream signal, suggesting that copper can stimulate the activity of these kinases. So, taken together, we uncovered this unexpected role of copper regulation of the MAP kinase pathway. And this is the first time that a mammalian kinase has been shown to be regulated by copper. So it's rather novel. And hence, we're now trying to investigate whether other kinases may be regulated in a similar manner. Moreover, this is the first example in concrete mechanism by which copper can regulate mammalian cell growth. But for us, it was more important to try to find out whether or not copper is also important in a tumorigenic process. And the tumorigenic process that we decided to test was BRAF-driven melanoma. So in 2002, a group searching for mutations in the RAS-RAF-MEC-ERK signaling cascade and a panel of human cancer cell lines found that 60% of metastatic melanomas harbor a point mutation in the serine-threonine kinase BRAF. This is an effector protein of RAS. More interestingly, they found that this mutation was found in the benign nevi for melanoma, suggesting that it is the driver mutation in melanoma. And so in terms of targeted therapies, now having the driver for melanoma, many drug companies have been looking for specific inhibitors of BRAF V600E ever since. And there's been a lot of progress in this field over the last 5 years, and I'll summarize that here. So normally for metastatic melanoma treatment, people were given chemotherapies like dacarbazine, and that's what's depicted here. Where you see here on the y-axis, we're measuring progression-free survival, but on the x-axis is the months of survival. And the median survival for this patient, for these patients treated with dacarbazine, is about 2 months. And excitingly, most recently, Plexicon came out with a drug that specifically inhibits BRAF V600E. They saw an extension of progression-free survival in this cohort of patients, leading to a median progression-free survival of about 5 months. So this is was proof of principle that targeting the driver oncogene in cancer can be efficacious. But what about inhibiting the kinases downstream, which we found to be copper binding kinases? In 2002, a group had the hypothesis that both RAS-driven cancers and RAF-driven cancers would be similarly sensitive to downstream pathway inhibition. And so they tested this by using a pharmacological inhibitor of the MEK1/2 kinases and a panel of cancer cell lines shown here. And here they're looking at the growth inhibition when these cell lines are treated with this MEK1/2 inhibitor. And what you can see very quickly is that the BRAF-driven cell lines are exquisitely sensitive to MAP kinase pathway and activation, while the RAS and RAF wild-type cell lines are not, and the NRAS mutant melanoma cell lines are less sensitive, suggesting that BRAF-driven cancers are critically dependent upon MAP kinase pathway activation. And because of this result, many companies have also been trying to find specific MEK1/2 inhibitors as well. And so this is a phase 3 clinical trial data of patients with BRAF-driven metastatic melanoma in comparison to the chemotherapy. And as I showed previously, the progression-free survival in the chemotherapeutic group is about 2 months. Treatment with this MEK1/2 inhibitor, trametinib, extended survival out to about 5 months, leading to its FDA approval as well. So can you combine these two drugs? For a long time in the cancer field, people have not been treating with two inhibitors that will hit the same linear pathway, thinking that you wouldn't get synergy in this case. However, when GSK used their BRAF inhibitor and their MEK1/2 inhibitor, they found that combining these two drugs could lead to an extension of survival out to about 9 months. So this proves that inhibiting these pathways in multiple ways is efficacious. So what about copper chelation in that context? So given our previously discovered new signaling paradigm, we wanted to find out whether or not alterations in copper availability would change MAP kinase pathway activation downstream of oncogenic BRAF, and whether or not that would change tumor genesis. So to do this, we went back to our genetically defined cell lines. We stably expressed oncogenic BRAF and looked at activation of the pathway. As expected, we see activation of the pathway as read out by phosphorylation of ERK. And if we take these same cells and inject them into immunocompromised mice, we get tumor formation. If we express oncogenic BRAF in the CTR1 null cells, we see a reduction in the phosphorylation of ERK. And if we take these same cells and inject them into mice, we see a complete reduction of tumor growth over time. And this leads to about a 2-week delay in tumor growth. And because the loss of copper can have pleiotropic effects on cells, we rescued this effect. And what was interesting about this, we were able to rescue the defect in tumor growth by re-expressing CTR1 wild type, but not a transport defective mutant to CTR1, which suggests that the copper transport activity of this protein is required for this phenotype. So next we wanted to understand whether or not there was a relationship between copper availability and endogenous BRAF signaling and tumor genesis. And in order to do this, we used human cell lines that are BRAF mutation positive, specifically melanoma cell lines derived at Duke University. And we knocked down the endogenous CTR1 and looked at pathway activation, as read out by phosphorylation of ERK. And as we reduce the levels of CTR1, we find that we can reduce MAP kinase pathway activation irrespective of genotype. So even in the BRAF wild-type cells, the loss of CTR1 leads to a reduction in the phosphorylation of ERK. And the same is true for our BRAF mutation-positive cell lines. However, if we take these same cells and inject them into immunocompromised mice and test tumor growth over time. So here we're looking at tumor volume on the y-axis and the time it takes to get to a tumor of a certain size on the x-axis. We find that the BRAF wild-type cells, when CTR1 is knocked out, do not require copper import for their growth. However, the BRAF mutant positive cell lines require CTR1 for their growth. So suggesting that copper import is selective to BRAF mutation positive cell lines. But can we test this in a more physiologically relevant system? So in order to do this, we've been using genetically engineered mouse models of BRAF-driven cancers. Specifically, in this case, we'll be looking at a lung cancer model driven by a pre-activatable allele of BRAF in the presence of two P53 flox alleles. And when we administer pre-recombinase intranasally, we get activation of this BRAF allele and loss of the P53 flox alleles. So that allowed us to assess in animals what pathway activation looked like when we turn on tumors.